Our first guest is a man of many, many talents. He is an accomplished actor, a best-selling author, and a Grammy Award-winning musician. This is his new album with the Steep Canyon Rangers entitled Rare Bird Alert. Please welcome back to the program, Steve Martin, everybody. Hey. Hey, Steve, how are you?
Hey, very
looking
nice.
Well.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I was just saying, you look fit, and welcome back. Always a pleasure to see
you. I love to do your show. It's so relaxing to do a show where I can just phone it in. I love doing it.
Okay.
And thank you for holding that album. It's so big looking, and that's the vinyl, but it's actually the CD, and they have to make new players now.
You got to get the extra big CD player.
Yes. Yeah. It's available in CD and as an illegal download, I should tell you.
Well, congratulations on this.
Well, now, you don't know.
Are we going to hear a little, well, it's banjo music. How can it be bad, for
that's
God's sake?
Absolutely, there's many ways, actually. We're going to do a song later with the Steep Canyon Rangers, but it's going to be an a cappella song.
Is that right?
Yeah, do you know what that is?
That means without accompaniment?
Yes. Wow. You know?
Thank you.
I am going to take back now a lot of the things I've been saying about you.
Yeah, well. And I would like to solve the puzzle. Speaking of...
You stepped out for that. That's all right. I think I missed something, yes.
Now, listen, I was surprised to read, not surprised, I guess impressed, that you, in fact, have embraced the technology of Twitter.
Yes, I have. I'm on Twitter now,
wow.
And I've been tweeting.
Yeah. And a lot of people follow.
I got banned from a show, actually, for using the past tense of tweet.
Actually banned. Sorry.
I got into it because Tom Hanks was doing it. And I said, what are you doing? Come on, what are you doing?
Right.
And he said, well, this is a way to reach people who are interested in what I'm doing. And I can talk about a movie I'm doing. I thought, well, that's sort of interesting because, you know, when I come on your show, right. You know, there's 5 million people watching. And I know that at least 3 million have absolutely no interest in what I'm doing. And so I can be on Twitter and have, you know, I have about 800,000 followers.
Wow.
I can actually talk to them directly. But I've been doing mostly comedy. I haven't really been promoting.
But now let me ask you a question because
what an appropriate place.
Yes.
Or you know, we could sit silently and you could ask me later.
Yes. I've had nights like that. Now,
I've seen them.
But the Twitter, what kinds of things? I don't understand the technology. So what do you say? That to me would be the burden. What do I say that goes out to these millions of people?
Well, for example, I tweeted about something that happened to me. I made a mistake. I went on Craigslist and I hired a handyman. And I should have known better because his name was Creepy Guy.
Creepy Guy.
Creepy Guy. And I invited him over, and I had a water heater to repair in my basement. And we went down, and then he said, I'll repair your water heater, but I also must tie you up first. And I said, fine. And so... But he did repair the water heater, and he untied me and paid him, and then I...
He untied you then?
Yes, I paid him, and then I tweeted his photo. And we have his photo here.
This is the handyman?
Yeah.
Wow.
So... That's...
Looks to me, it looks like his fly is open. Is that, do you?
Well, I think you get the name Creepy Guy.
Yeah,
from
I see.
That.
Yeah.
And then what's interesting, this was in LA, and then when I flew here and I checked into the hotel in New York, I found that green hammer between the bed sheets, which is.
a little weird.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Boy, well.
But that's kind of the funny stuff I've been doing on
yeah.
Twitter.
I hope you've learned your lesson.
And I've been making a ton of money from it.
On the Twitter?
No, you don't get anything. But for example, I can tweet that I'm on your show.
Right.
And then your numbers will go, whew, level out or do something. I don't know.
But now, I have two things I want to say. Steep Canyon Rangers, what a romantic name for a bluegrass banjo band. What
oh,
a great
they're
name.
Fantastic.
And where does that come from? Is there a steep canyon that
well,
you're
Well, I challenged this, them on this mm-hmm. because, you know, you can't really roam a steep canyon.
No, you can't.
No, you would just...
You're there.
You would go into yeah, a crevice.
That's right. Yeah.
But I don't think they... You know, they're not really called on it.
I see.
But they're a great band from North Carolina. I'm very lucky to be with them. You're oh. gonna, they're going to...
Well, I bet there is a steep canyon in North Carolina.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing is I heard you were arrested. Now, I don't know...
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Paul and I were talking about this in the makeup room.
Uh-huh.
We had heard...
No, look, there's a lot of internet rumors. No, there was a shoplifting thing, which was completely false, and you know how those rumors get around.
What is?
Oh, yeah, this is the latest sort of celebrity thing that people a lot of celebrities wear.
The latest celebrity
yeah.
thing.
I'm going to return it to the. To the jewelry shop. My,
yeah.
my publicist forgot yeah. to return
now,
that.
What? What? But now we have some footage.
A footage?
Some security camera footage?
I'm sure you don't have any of that because I'm an AFTRA. And actually, if you run that security footage, then you would have to pay me because I'm in the union.
Right, we're fully prepared to pay you.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm fully prepared to walk.
No, seriously. I mean, I don't have to show it.
Oh. Well, I would actually like the money.
Yeah. All right, I'm told now that this is security footage. Do you know where it is?
Well, I think it was in a supermarket. That's where they claim this alleged. I went in to buy a ham.
Eat a lot of ham, do you?
Well,
you don't seem like a big ham guy to me. All right, let's take a look. Here we go.
Okay, I'm looking around, and I find a very nice ham.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah. Okay. There you.
Yeah.
Okay. Come on out.
You're coming out now.
Okay. Okay. So. Now.
Well, there you go.
Now I'm...
All right. That's what you go shopping in, is the suit and the tie. I like that. You're
yeah, well,
a man of great style.
But now I'm wearing an ankle bracelet for the rest of the show.
We'll be well better than having a ham in your pants for the rest of the show. We'll be right
well,
back with Steve Morrow.
Oh, yeah.
And the moon was yellow.
I know that this album
you
have like guest
stars. Oh, we have guest stars, absolutely.
Yes. Yeah, like who are we talking about?
Well, this is unbelievable. Paul McCartney.
No.
Yes, and the Dixie Chicks. Now.
Wow.
I have to tell you something. Yeah, see, there's Paul, and there's the Dixie Chicks.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell we played with the photo a little bit. First of all, I wrote all the songs on this record, and
thank you.
And by the way, they're all terrible.
No, actually.
The idea of having Paul McCartney sing a song that I wrote has to be one of the most exciting things of his life.
I think.
But let me tell you. Let me tell you how this happened. Lorne Michaels, who's the producer
Saturday
of Saturday
Night,
Night Live.
Mm-hmm.
Good one. That's
yeah.
why you're there and I'm here. He came to me like a year ago and he says, you know, Steve, he said, you don't impose on your friends enough.
Really?
Yeah. And I thought, you know, I don't. I'm very shy about asking
sure.
people to
well,
do something or something like
yeah.
that. And I thought, you know what? And so I had this song. It's sort of a lighthearted love song. And Tony Trischka, the producer of the record, his son, who's 15, suggests, we were trying to think, who could sing this? And he said, Paul McCartney. Mm. And I thought, gee, that's absolutely right. And first of all, it's a real tribute to Paul McCartney that a 15-year-old suggests,
yes.
thought of him, you
yes.
know. And I thought, okay, I'm going to try this, because that's perfect. And so I got, now, I've met Paul McCartney maybe 3 times in my life, so I can't really call him a friend. Mm. But Paul doesn't know that. He might, you know, he might think we're friends, because he meets so many people, he can't remember
sure,
who his friends are.
How would he
are.
Know?
So I managed to get an email of his Paul's assistant. So I wrote, at first I recorded the song in my iPhone and played it on the banjo and I sang it myself. So it's a little modest recording and I emailed to his assistant and I waited about a month and I heard nothing. But I knew Paul was on tour so it was going to take some time. So about a month later I got an email back from Paul. It said, I'm on tour, haven't had a chance to listen to the song yet, but don't worry, I will. And then another like 3 weeks went by and then finally he said, I'll do it.
Oh boy.
And I thought, wow, this is yeah. fantastic. So we went in and to Asheville, and where we recorded the whole album, and we laid down the track. I don't know what they're applauding for. I laid down Asheville, I don't know. Whatever. And I still don't know what they're applauding for. And I went in and laid down the dummy track, and I sang it again. And then we sent that off to Paul. And now it's time to schedule Paul. So I wrote him, I said, we've got to set the date. So we set the date. And then now we're like 3 days before we're going to record Paul in Amagansett. And we get an email and from his assistant. And the email says, Paul wants to know what part you want him to sing.
Ooh.
And I said, well, we thought the whole thing. And he said, well, Paul thought he was going to back you up. And I said, I thought, what? And I went through all the emails. Did I mislead him or something, you know? And I said, well, okay, but I'm a terrible singer. So then I got an email back from Paul, and he said, well, as a little-known band from Liverpool once said, we can work it out. So I went in, and now I record the song again with me singing, doing my best efforts. And we did every trick in the book, you know, with the echo and reverb and every, you know, sound trick. I sound like the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, you know. And so we send that off to him. And so now I haven't heard back. So we fly into Amagansett, and we're waiting for Paul to arrive at this little studio, actually in someone's house, a very nice person. And Paul arrives. And he said, you know, when you said you were a terrible singer, I thought you were being humble, but you weren't. And he ended up singing the entire song, the most charming guy in the world, friendly to everyone.
Yeah.
I learned a lot. Uh-huh. And so nice. And finally, we recorded it for a couple of hours. And we said, okay, I think we got it. He said, oh, let me do it a couple more times. He was that energetic
nice.
And enthusiastic.
And it's right here on this collection
yes,
entitled Rare Bird Alert. I love the title. And it's from Ornithology. I don't know, I guess.
I feel like I'm talking to Dick Cavett all of a sudden. it's actually from bird watching.
Yeah, that's why I invoked ornithology.
I know what ornithology is.
I know
it's
what bird watching is.
You have fungus on your toes.
Exactly. That's right. We're running late on time, but beautiful.
I mean, you can go to commercial.
Such a beautiful instrument. I wonder if you could just kind of point out. This looked like an antique.
A banjo is such a beautiful thing.
Oh, my God. Gorgeous. I'm not gonna play it, but just I thought I would show you how beautiful a banjo can be and describe some of the parts, because a lot of people, this is called the peg head, mm-hmm. and this is the neck, and this is the inlay in the right. neck, and this is called the pot, mm-hmm. and this is the head, and this is the vagina.
Wait a minute.
What am I thinking of?
You're thinking of the past tense of tweet.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
That's what you're thinking of.
Right.
All right. Well, we'll have some music with Steve when we come back. Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen. And now, ladies and gentlemen, performing a song from their new album, A Rare Bird Alert, here are Steve Martin and the Steep Canyon Rangers. Gentlemen.
Thank you. You know, religious people have such beautiful music and art, and atheists really have nothing. Until now. This is the entire atheist hymnal right here. A little song called Atheists Don't Have No Songs.
Christians have their hymns and pages.
Hymns and pages.
Hava Nagilas for the Jews.
For the Jews.
Baptists have the Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages.
Atheists just sing the blues.
Romantics play
Clair de Lune.
Clair de Lune.
Born again, sing He is risen. But no one ever wrote a tune. For godless existentialism.
For atheists,
there's no good news.
They'll never sing
a song of faith.
In their songs,
they have a rule.
The He is always lowercase. He is always lowercase.
Some folks sing
a bacchantata.
Bacchantata.
Lutherans get Christmas trees. Atheist songs add up to nada.
Up to nada.
But they do have Sundays free.
Pentecostals sing to heaven.
Coptics had the Book of Scrolls.
Numerologists count to seven.
Atheists have rock and roll.
For atheists,
there's no good news.
They'll never sing
a song of faith.
In their songs,
they have a rule.
The He is always lowercase. The He is always lowercase.
Atheists don't have no songs.
Christians have their hymns and pages.
Hymns and pages.
Hava Nagilas for the Jews.
For the Jews.
Baptists have the Rock of Ages.
Rock of Ages.
Atheists just sing the blues.
Catholics
dress up for Mass
and listen to
Gregorian chants.
Atheists just take a pass.
Watch football in their underpants.
Atheists
don't have no songs.
Wow. Beautiful. Thank you so much. Good to see you. Beautiful job.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Martin, always a pleasure. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Steve Martin and the Steep Canyon Rangers, ladies and gentlemen. Rare bird alert. There they are. Thank you again. Good night, everybody.
Now, stay tuned for Craig Ferguson. This is Alan Coulter speaking. Good night, everybody.
Listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. I'm so glad you're in a great mood. We have a special treat for you folks tonight. Two big stars backstage. Oh. First of all, Steve Martin. Is he back there?
Really?
Steve Martin, yeah. Steve, how are you?
Hey.
Good to see you. And also, I think Tom Hanks was nice enough to drop by tonight. Is Tom Hanks also back
backstage?
There? Look at that.
Wow. This is really...
Now, one of them will come out and be a guest on the program tonight, and I think by your applause, we will tell who will be our surprise guest for tonight. Alan, tell everybody how this is going to work, will you?
Well, a recording of tonight's program will be delivered via bonded courier to the testing laboratories of Televisual Solutions, Inc., an independent television judging organization whose decision is final. Sound engineers will analyze and quantify the applause on the tape and subject their findings to rigorous verification procedures established by the Audio Engineering Society. And the results of the applause analysis will be made available to The Late Show within 6 to 8 weeks.
That's great. Thank you. That's great. Thank you very much for helping. And then the other thing is, I alluded to this a little bit earlier. This is when the networks, you get CBS, you get NBC, you get ABC, and you get Fox. and they all bring in advertisers and people, and they show them how great the new fall season is going to be. And so the guy who owns CBS, Les Moonves, called me about 6 weeks ago, and he says, and P.S., don't spread this around, but they were a little panicky because this was right in the middle of that Charlie Sheen stuff, and they were just dizzy. Well, they just didn't know what was going to happen because Charlie Sheen was like an atomic bomb in a pinball machine. And so he calls me up and he says, Dave, actually, Mr. Letterman. Stop it. And I said, yes, what can I do for you? And he said, would you mind? He says, we want to open up the presentation. He said, to Carnegie Hall. We want to open up the presentation with a real blockbuster or a real bang to, you know, get people in a good mood, get them feeling great, and everything will be fantastic. And then it'll be smooth sailing when we announce the new schedule. Well, I was flattered. I was honored. So I called Paul, and I said, let's do this. Let's do this thing. And Paul got together, had some music and a piano and stuff, and then we called our friend Steve, and he jumped right in and took the whole thing over.
Yeah,
so now it's me, it's Paul, it's Steve, and it turns out Les Moonves is in the thing, but it didn't. And I think what happened was, between the time he asked me when he thought he was in trouble and the time we did this thing for him, they got a hold of Ashton Kutcher. And I think when that happened, he said, we don't need Letterman now. You know what I'm talking about?
Well, I don't know.
Well, you were there.
I know. And the piece itself that you made was, I don't know, maybe you should show it, you know, tonight.
I'm going to show it tonight. And I don't, thank you, sir. Just keep in mind, this is something we put our hearts and our souls and our guts into because we felt the weight of this responsibility. Mm. And God bless Steve. What a showman. What a master showman. And God bless you.
Oh.
So this is what was going to happen earlier today. And then at the last minute, well, you'll see what happens at the last minute. I'm blaming Ashton Kutcher.
All right.
Roll it. Okay.
It's gonna be a big, big season. It's gonna be a big, big season.
That's good, but hit the big.
It's gonna be a big, big. It's gonna be a big, big season.
yeah, a little vibrato on the zun.
It's gonna be a big, big season.
It's good. What note is that?
It's none of these.
Okay, put it down together.
It's gonna be a big, big season.
Yeah. Sorry, guys, your number's cut.
Cut? I haven't been cut from a show since 2010.
You're incompetent. Did you say incompetent?
Yes.
Thanks.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, well, it's a little too late.
This is, it's from the Sioux City Journal, Sioux City, Iowa. Graceland Park Cemetery lot sleeps five like new. What? And finally, this is from the Dispatch, Lexington, North Carolina. This is an item in the television listings. Friday, late night guests, David Letterman, Steve Martin. Well, that's not even funny, is it? Oh. Why would that be?
Hi, Dave.
Steve,
that's okay. Well, that's okay. It's all right. No problem.
Oh, you're right here in the...
You're right, Dave. It's not funny, but it is news. Uh-huh. It's big news. I'll be appearing on the show this Friday, and I'm super excited. Once again, that's this Friday, right here on the I'm sorry, your name?
Dave Letterman.
Dave Letterman Show. It's going to be great. See ya. Bye.
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, here's tonight's top 10 list. Let's go. What? What is this? Paul, what?
Look at that. I'm not. This is Steve Martin.
It is Steve Martin. Look at
and
that.
And he's plugging with his signs. His Friday. Let's all get saw. That was one of his catchphrases.
Yes, very big. Steve Martin.
Look at him go.
Thank you. There he is.
Yeah.
How about that? He'll be on the show Friday. What a guy.
Promoting his appearance. Love it.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's tonight's top 10 list. Let's try. Ladies and gentlemen, the category for tonight's top 10 list,
sorry.
Herman Cain.
Sorry,
top 10
Dave.
Herman Cain pickup line. Oh my God! Steve Martin! Oh my goodness!
Sorry.
Whoa!
Isn't that something?
That's crazy!
Wonderful!
Wow! Steve, for heaven's sakes, what are you doing here?
Well, Dave, I'm just in a tizzy. which one of these suits do you think looks better for my Friday appearance?
We're right in the middle of a show.
Well, Dave, I'm really sorry about that, but it just sounded so dead out here, I assumed it was a rehearsal.
Yeah.
So, what do you think, the brown or the silver?
Brown or silver, you know, it's up to you. Either one is fine. I don't care.
You know, I can't do this alone.
Oh, for God's sakes. The appearance is 2 days away. It's Friday. Today is Wednesday. You got 2 days to figure this out.
Decide!
All right, I'll... Brown.
You've really helped. The silver.
It's,
Dave.
Come on. I'll be done. Whoa. Hey, look at there. How about,
Hi, yes. Hi. I'm Steve.
Can I help you?
Yes. I'm Steve from Atlanta.
Uh-huh. You're not. I know you're not from Atlanta, but go ahead.
Yeah, I just have a quick question for you. Who's going to be on the show tomorrow?
Well, Steve, we both know that tomorrow you will be our guest on the
show. Oh!
We also both know that you've been promoting your appearance tomorrow night on this show all week long.
Oh. It's funny, I didn't know that. But who's going to be hosting tomorrow?
I will be the host tomorrow night.
Oh, wow. Well, don't worry, I won't pull out. And,
thank you.
And I'm just curious, who else is going to be on the show tomorrow?
Oh, it's going to be a great show.
Oh, it's fantastic. All okay, right. I'll see you then. Okay.
Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen. Our first guest puts the multi in multi-talented. He is an accomplished actor, a Grammy Award-winning musician, and a best-selling author. His most recent novel, This Is an Object of Beauty, is available now in the paperbacks beginning November 15th. This book, which I have read, is so entertaining, and it's what they call a page-turner. You can hardly wait to get back to the house to keep reading it. When you buy it in paperback, you will then also buy it in the hardcover. That's what I did. He's the always entertaining, the always engaging, the lovely, the talented. To know him is to love him. Steve Martin.
Thank you very much. I feel like I've worn out my welcome.
No. Now listen, let me tell you something. Okay. I was thinking about this today. You've been here every day of the week promoting this appearance tonight, above and beyond the call of duty. giving a lot of time and a lot of effort and very funny appearances, and here you are tonight. And this is not just this week and tonight. This is reminiscent of the 30 or so years that we have known you from the very beginning, way, way back at NBC. You've always been so generous and so kind to come and share your talents with us, and I can't thank you enough.
Well, let me thank you. Bye. Thank you. But let me explain something. You know, you don't know this, but when I was a little kid, I used to run home from school, go to my room, get all dressed up, and play Late Show with David Letterman.
You know, I didn't know that.
Yeah. It's an honor for me to be here.
Well, thank you very much. And it's flattering in kind of a creepy way, but thanks.
Yeah. And if I could just say one thing, you know, thank you for commenting on my book and saying it's a page turner, but you know, every book is a page turner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Steve, I admire many things about you. Tell me a little bit about
you. Mean,
your...
As in M-I-N-I?
No, M-A-N-Y.
Oh, okay, thank you.
You live in, I know, originally from Arizona, moved to Orange County. You live in California and...
That's wrong.
And in New York.
I'm born in Texas.
Really born in Texas?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What town in Texas?
I was born in Waco, Texas.
Waco, Texas, no kidding. Mm-hmm. And then moved to Orange County?
And when I was five, I moved to California, mm-hmm. leaving behind a wife and two kids.
How are the? You ever hear from them?
No, I lost contact. Contact.
Yeah, but now you live in California and also New York City, and I wonder which place do you spend more time? Which do you prefer?
I live in California, mm-hmm. but I do spend time.
You have a lovely home here
in Manhattan, mm-hmm. and you know it's interesting because in California, you know I'm known. You know I'm a hometown guy, and I'm thought of as you know a hometown guy who made good. Here in Manhattan, I'm thought of as the lesser Woody Allen who'll show up.
Well, But I know, because you have very distinct features and very popular, people must be all over you when you come to New York City.
Yes, I do get recognized. You know, I think there's three levels of celebrity. Mm. You know, when you're first starting out, you're not famous enough. Right. Then if you have success, you're too famous. And then it sort of settles into famous just right. And that's when people go, hey, love your work, you know, and you get a table in a restaurant, and you, you know, you still qualify for the celebrity tax break, which you have to, that's why, you know, I'm always cautious who I vote for.
Yeah, sure.
You don't want to.
They won't do away with it.
Well, how do you feel about the celebrity tax break?
Yeah.
And you do get, you know, you don't get recognized as much in California because you're always in your
in
car.
In your car, sure.
So you have to actually drag people into your car.
Now, you did a little of that, didn't you, at one time?
Yeah, you have to go, hey, look at this, say thanks, get out. Now. But in Manhattan, you know, when you're famous for a long time, you just accumulate all kinds of funny, well, I don't know if they're funny, we'll find out, stories. You know, of people recognize you. But this, within the last month, I had two very strange ones. I was, once I was in Central Park, and you know, when I go out, I wear, you know, sunglasses and a hat. I'm not trying to disguise myself, but you know, I have very delicate skin. I want to
protect you.
Protect it.
Yeah,
and you're wearing a coat, you know, and I dress, you know, I don't dress in flamboyant clothes or anything. And a guy came up to me, you know, sort of from behind me, and he said something that was just a real ironic brain twister for me. He came up and said, enjoy your anonymity.
Doesn't make any sense.
And then recently I was coming out of my building, and there was a group of young men, probably 16 or 17, and I could see them out of the corner of my eye, and one of them said, look, there's that actress. What is that?
That's the kind of thing
what that meant.
Yeah, to stay with you all day, you know, though, won't it?
Yeah.
Exactly where
you
do
know,
we
you
untangle
go home,
this?
Get the side view mirror out. You know, go, I don't know.
Who is he thinking of? now, here's maybe you mentioned this in your book, Born Standing Up, which is also tremendous. I love reading
Thank
that.
Thank you. But maybe, not a page turner for you, though.
No, it was a page turner. The time you met Elvis Presley.
Elvis Presley.
This I thought was lovely. This is a great story.
This would, you know, I was it was about 1972, so I was not famous, you know, and I was working in Vegas, opening for Ann Margaret, you know, and they knew each other. They had worked together.
Right.
And I thank Ann Margaret and her husband Roger Smith for hiring me because I had a weird act. And
like what kind of stuff were you
doing then? I'll show you. This was one of my bits. Like I you know, I had sort of a like a funny magic act, and this was one of the bits I did. I would say, and now, ladies and gentlemen, the napkin trick. I go like this. And I'd really drag this out, you know. And I'd bow, and I'd, you know, thank you. And following Ann Margaret in the next week was Elvis Presley, and he came in to see the show that night. And so now the show's over, and we're all in our dressing rooms afterwards, and I look down the hall, and I see this beautiful woman coming down the hall, and it's Priscilla, his wife. And she sort of, I have no idea, it's Priscilla, anyway, she peels away, and then there's Elvis, and he's all in white with this black hair, and he's got that huge, this is the thin Elvis, by the way, he looks great. He's got this beautiful diamond buckle, you know, that celebrates his appearances at the Hilton Hotel, and he walks by me, and he sees me, and I'm kind of like this, and he says, son, you have an oblique sense of humor.
Oblique.
Oblique. Then he came back after he's talked to Anne Margaret for a while. He came back to talk to me and my manager at the time. And we talked for a little while, and I'm sort of, you know, excited. And then one of his employees, a little man, came up to him and said, "Elvis, we have to go." Elvis said,
"It's all right."
And I know that this man was his guy who came up to him whenever he was talking to someone to get him out of situations.
Mm-hmm, sure.
And so the fact that he said, "It's all right," you know, it's a big compliment. And then the conversation kind of stalled, and he said,
"Want to see my guns?"
And no. Yeah, and he had three guns on him, and they were loaded.
Really?
Yeah. And he had one here and one back here, which was a Derringer. It was all engraved, a collector item. And he took out and he put all the bullets in his hand, and handed it over so we could go, "Yeah. Great. Good. Yeah." And then I was hoping for the guy to come back and go, "Elvis, we have to go." I wish I had my guy.
Yeah, and your guy.
Yeah.
That's a great thing, though.
Yeah.
Boy, that's...
To meet Elvis?
Now, I know we're running a little late, but tell me, how did the napkin trick go over in Las Vegas? Was it well received?
It was a funny comedy bit that went over. It went over. Well, you know, I was working Vegas, man.
Sure,
come on.
Of course, why not?
Had to work.
Now, I was stunned to find out. I had no idea. There's so much television now. There's like 1,000 channels, and everybody got the late night shows and the morning shows and the daytime shows. You have a daytime show, and I'm so embarrassed. I had no idea about this.
Yeah, well, you know, I've had a daytime talk show with Marty Short.
Marty Short.
Yes, and
he's
great.
He's great,
and you know, it's hard to get traction because there's so many talk shows.
That's what I'm saying, yeah.
And you know, I don't like to come on to promote, but this show has been on for 2.5 years.
Your show.
Yeah. And, you know, it's hard, you know, we're having trouble finding an audience.
Right.
I mean, you know, even a studio audience. We, you know, it's just we can't get publicity. And so what I've done is I put together what they call a sizzle reel. You know what that is?
Well, I think I can infer what it is.
It's you take a video of your best stuff.
Yeah.
And you clip it all together into a hot sizzle reel. And it gets the audience sizzling hot, you know. To see
now, do we
want
to
show.
See the sizzle reel now, or do you want to see it now? Okay, I'm excited.
You want to see the sizzle
reel?
I'm
ready.
So this is like a collection of stuff over the best stuff over the 2.5 years we've been on the air.
I feel so stupid, Steve. I had no idea.
Yeah, you got to get the ratings up.
Oh, I understand. You know? Yeah. All right, so that's it. We're going to see the. What do you call the show?
It's called Steve and Marty.
Steve and Marty. Here it is, the sizzle reel.
Mm-hmm.
It's time for the Steve and Marty Show. And now, here's Steve Martin and Martin Short.
Hey, how you doing?
How are you all?
The traffic was so thick.
How thick?
That it was hard. It was so thick that it was actually quite hard to move through.
Our next guest used to be much more successful, but then she gained a tremendous amount of weight.
And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like I love you.
I ran out of breath. Now, our next guest is an actress, and I really don't know who she is. So the cheese goes between the bread.
Between the bread.
You were in The Addams Family, is that correct?
That's right.
Yeah, that was a big flop, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And what is this called?
This is called a grilled cheese.
Hey, Marty, do your impression of Paul, because I think that's funny.
I love to play for Dave Letterman. Yeah.
That's so funny.
No, I think it's great, too.
Oh, don't put your arms there.
What?
What's your big beat?
Oh, please, don't put your hands
on. Yeah, don't do that.
What? Can you describe, say, one of the plays you've been in, as though we were interested? Go ahead.
Let's see. I did Waiting for Godot. It's sort of an existential...
You don't bring me flowers anymore.
Hey, do your impression of Nathan.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I like to appear on Broadway.
No, well, make fun of him to his face. Oh, do it to
okay.
his face.
Okay. You guys are ass.
That is a sizzle reel.
Yeah.
I'm going to watch.
When, okay.
When and where can, like around the, where can I see it?
You
here?
Know, I don't know what channel it's on,
uh-huh.
which is a, that's a bad publicist.
Well, no, yeah, that's no. right. But that's why we have TV Guide,
yeah,
for God's
right,
sake.
Yeah.
Sure. We'll be right back with Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen. Mind if I show this?
Yeah, no, please do.
You were here, I think, about a year ago presenting. Yes. This is, and you helped me out, this is an award
right.
that you created for bluegrass banjo. Is it banjo strictly? Excellence.
Yes.
I guess that's
excellence
a tip off. Yeah.
Bluegrass and banjo.
Yep, and that, this is the second annual.
Right, that award was created by the great American artist Eric Fischel.
Mm-hmm.
And this year's winner. It also is accompanied with a check for $50,000.
Wow. Where does the money? Yeah.
Yes.
Where do you get that money?
The money comes from 8-year-old Chinese laborers.
That's very generous of
yeah,
them.
Yeah, it's nice of them.
Yes,
and,
it is.
Actually, I fund it myself.
Oh.
And this year's winner is a great, great bluegrass traditional banjo player in the best sense of the word. He's also an innovator, and his name is Sammy Sheeler, and he plays with the Lonesome River Band, who is a great, great bluegrass band.
Great.
And we could bring him out if you want.
That, yes, come on out.
We're going to bring him out. We got Sammy right Sheeler.
Sheeler.
And the Lonesome River Band.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
Hi, boys.
Yeah.
How's it going?
Welcome.
Nice to have you here.
Lonesome
this
River
is
Band.
The Lonesome River Band back
yes.
here.
Good I mean, to see I'm you. Curious,
thank you very much.
Why are they so lonesome, Sam?
Yeah.
Because we play bluegrass music.
I see.
Well, you want to give him the
yes.
check? That's
Here's
great.
Here's your check for $50,000. Congratulations.
Thank you, Steve.
And
what are you going to spend most of that on picks?
Yeah.
I don't know.
You just like a
right.
think
Thank
are.
You very much.
Yeah. This is such a great honor, and you forgot to sign it.
Oh, I'm sorry. Do you have a pen or something?
You know, I don't.
I'll just take care of it later.
I have one.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Sign that.
So it's good. Just sign it. Sharpie, and
that's great.
And
I'm just
wait a week to cash okay. that. Anyway, yeah.
Does the Sammy the band, the whole group gets to they divide up the? Is that how it works? They
no, it? Actually, it's just dedicated to the banjo player exclusively.
Oh.
Yeah. So,
right, guys.
A loyal band. Very loyal band.
Well, congratulations again. And you, by the way, received an award for your performing in Bluegrass with the Banjo, Entertainer of the Year.
With the Steep Canyon Rangers.
The
yes,
Steep Canyon.
IBMA, the International Bluegrass Music Association. And by the way, that's one of the greatest awards I've ever received because it is the most recent.
Mr. Martin,
thank
always
you.
A pleasure. Now, you guys are coming back a
We're
little
later? We're coming to come back.
All right,
I'm going to get to accompany them.
All right, we'll be right back with Felicity Jones. Guests, as we know now, an acclaimed bluegrass band with their current CD is entitled Still Learning. And while they're performing, just keep in mind that this number cost Steve Martin $50,000. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Lonesome River Band with special guest Steve Martin. Take it away, boys!
On the job and working overtime. Even though you've called him on the phone and you can't get him on the line. Now you've been told that he's been seen over in another town with a pretty little blonde in a red sports car riding with the top laid down.
Oh, Molly, can you tell me, are you sure he's doing you right? Or is he somewhere with another? Oh, Molly,
Molly,
Molly, where's your man tonight? Well, you need someone to love you true, someone just like me. And I will never do you wrong, that's a guarantee. And you won't have to call and check on me when it gets late at night. 'Cause I promise you I'll always be right close by your side. Oh, Molly, can you tell me, are you sure he's doing you right? Or is he somewhere with another? Oh, Molly,
Molly,
Molly, where's your man tonight?
Yeah, boy.
Oh, Molly, can you tell me, our truth is doing right? Or is he somewhere?
Thank you, sir. God, I enjoyed that. What is this? Mandolin? Very nice. Thank you. Congratulations, Sammy. Congratulations. That was beautiful. That was just great. I really enjoyed that. That was tremendous. Thank you very much. That was the Lonesome River Band and Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen. How about that? Nice going. That's it. We'll see you Monday. Good night, everybody.
Now, stay tuned for Craig Ferguson. This is Alan Cawthon speaking. Good night, everybody.
Thank you very much. Is that New York City or Gotham?
It's both at the same time.
Thank you very much. You know, the funniest thing, a couple of months ago, my assistant, Mary, stuck her head in the office and she said, "Hey, dumbass, you have a phone call." And it turned out it was the mayor. And he said, "Do me a favor, put in a little park out there on Broadway. It'll be exciting. It'll be fun for the tourists. It'll brighten up the city, and you'll be a hero." And I said, "Okay, so look, we put in Dave Letterman Park, and I think it turned out pretty well. See it right there, look at it. Yeah, that's Dave Letterman Park. Right.
Well, that's nice.
And that the heavy set guy in the tan suit is out there every day.
I see.
Little did I know that other celebrities were going to be doing it as well, and frankly, I think they're abusing what should be a lovely addition to the city.
Sure.
You know what I'm talking about?
Well, no, I'm
Well, here, look at this guy. He started his own park right next to mine. Look.
Hey, kid, want to buy a beer?
I'm not 21.
Yeah, take it on me.
Enjoy the park. Want some cigarettes?
Underage to kids, beer. Oh, my God, ladies and gentlemen. Can you believe it? Wow. Here's where fun. This is Action Town. Let's go back outside and see what's going on in that park nonsense again. What is? Oh, look at this.
And here's your firearm all loaded up. Careful with that. The safety's broken.
Your park is so much better than Dave Letterman Park.
Oh, well, thank you. It's sad what happened to his park.
Ladies and gentlemen, oh, this is very exciting. We love this man. We love when he's here. He's a very funny, multi-talented guy. Right here is a new collection, this new DVD compilation. It's entitled Steve Martin, His Television Stuff. It's in stores now. Ladies and gentlemen, comedy legend, the one, the only, Steve Martin. Steve, come on. Look great, Steve.
Thank you very much.
You're always very well dressed. I don't want to embarrass you, but let me just say here at the beginning, for me to be sitting here next to you, it's beyond a pleasure, as in seeing an old friend. But that's part of it. I have so much respect for you as a comedian, just a funny guy, a man who writes very well, and an author not only of books, novels, and your biography, which I love, but also plays. Now we haven't even begun to talk about music. I mean, oh my God, what a multifaceted, multi-talented guy. It's an honor to be sitting next to you.
Well, thank you very much. And let me say what an honor it is for me to be sitting next to the man who is sitting next to that man.
Okay, great.
Yeah,
I appreciate that.
Now, I don't know if I was rude when I first came out because I was shaking your hand and then I looked away to say hello to Paul. And I don't know if that's just maybe convenient for me to kill two birds with one stone.
Yeah.
I think maybe that's...
I don't believe you're the kind of guy who has ever drawn a rude breath in your life.
Oh, really? You think you're so smart.
Snotty about it.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
Well, Steve, how have you been, for God's sakes?
Oh, you know what? Tonight is not about me, man. Mm. I was so thrilled to hear that you got the Kennedy Center Award.
Oh, please. It's
award.
That's a fantastic thing. Well, it is fantastic thing.
It is.
But I don't...
It's one of the highest awards in the nation.
You received it in 2009?
Seven. But still, and it's one of the greatest nights because it's, you know, usually if you win an award, you have to perform and you have to write and do this. But this, you just sit there, you know. And they do all the work, and you don't have to prepare. You don't have to worry about going over. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, it's like doing your show. You know, you just, you know. Now, I know exactly where I was when I heard that you got this award. Mm. And because, you know...
Really?
Yeah. Because, you know, I tape everything during the day of me.
At your house, there is a 24-hour taping system?
Everywhere I go. It's for historical purposes.
Well, like for who? Who exactly?
Well, in case, let's say, the Smithsonian called or something.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Now, have they called?
No. No, they haven't. In fact, they're trying to return stuff I've given to them. But I have...
Excuse me.
I, uh,
I brought down the tape tonight, and I can show you.
Now,
the
this is tape of your life.
Yes.
Now, is it erasable after 24 hours? Is it sort of erasing, or is it continual?
Why would you want to erase?
Well, I don't know. I just, you might have a slow day.
Yeah,
we got the FedEx guy shows up, and that's
stuff.
It.
I just upload it.
I see. Okay. So this is a tape of where you were and what you were doing.
When I got the news. Can we roll the tape?
Yeah, sure. I'm dumbfounded that it exists. Take a look, Steve Martin.
Oh, thank you, Rodolfo. Oh, I see that David Letterman got the Kennedy Center Award. Well, I'm stunned, shocked, surprised, and completely taken aback. Marty Short.
Yeah. Yeah, you saw it? Yeah. Were you stunned, shocked, surprised? Yeah, yeah, you were stunned, shocked, surprised, and completely taken aback. Yeah, that's right. Yes, unlike you and me, Dave doesn't sing, dance, or act, or have any discernible talent whatsoever. Yeah, I was stunned, shocked, surprised. Hang on. I got another call coming in. Meryl Streep. Yeah, hi, Meryl. Did you see the news, too? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Were you stunned, shocked, surprised? Yeah, you were stunned, shocked, surprised, and completely taken aback. That's right. Yeah. Oh, hang on, Meryl. I got another call on a line I reserve for my no-talent friends. Just one second. Dave, hi, how are you? Yeah, congratulations, I'm so happy for you. No one deserves it less more. In fact, I was just chatting with some of my big-time showbiz friends, and none of us are stunned, shocked, surprised, and completely taken aback. Congratulations, buddy.
Oh, Rodolfo, would you bring me my Oscar?
Sir, you never won an Oscar.
Well, can you go to the garden and make me one out of twigs?
Make me one out of twigs. I'm stunned, shocked, and surprised.
Now, you might think that was all in fun, but it wasn't.
No, I'll tell you something. I'm very sensitive about this because I know that's actually the case.
Neither did Johnny Carson.
Oh, now you're invoking a higher spirit, my friend. Johnny Carson, and you both deserve it.
And I saw an old tape of Johnny Carson where he sang on the Jack Benny Show.
I saw it as well. He also played the drums.
Oh, everything I do now, you have done.
He also played the drums. He danced, and he did the magic.
But that's not what he's known for.
No.
He's known for what you do.
Yeah, but
very limited.
Yeah, I don't. But he could do all of those things. I can't.
You know, once I was on The Tonight Show.
Mm-hmm.
This was a long, long time ago when I first started. And, he was obviously one of the people I admired.
Mm.
And so during the... During the routine, I'm doing the thing, and he ended up doing an impression of Goofy the cartoon dog. You know, he'd go, no. And he did this thing, and I think he was a little embarrassed about it. And then we went to commercial, and I was just a young comedian starting out. And he leaned over to me during the commercial, and he said, "You'll do everything you ever knew." And it turned out to be true.
Well, it's absolutely true. I was talking to a friend of mine the other day. A guy comes on, a comedian, a first-time comedian, does not do well.
It's on the show recently?
On Johnny's show.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry, on Johnny's show. This is historical.
Oh, okay.
And, well, I mean historical in the sense that it's past. And I think you know the guy, and it was a very peculiar set anyway, and doesn't play well. So they come back to Johnny. Johnny's sitting at the desk, and Johnny says, "New, different." "We'll be right back." And that was it. Kid was never on ever again.
Yeah.
New, different.
Yeah. I like Steve Allen. I saw Steve Allen. Did you like, Steve Allen?
I love Steve Allen.
He was
sure.
The greatest. I remember this bit. I must have been 12. And he was playing a news reporter. And he says, "News travels so fast today. Throw me that newspaper." And they throw it to him, and he dropped it on the floor. And he picked it up, and it said, "Steve Allen drops newspaper on live television."
We'll be right back with Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen.
My name's
Johnny would do frequently. Let's just say he had a guest who was a little lackluster and it was time to get rid of the guest. He would always do this. He would tap the wood on his desk and he would say, "Glad to see your career's going so good." And that would be it. It was like it was all in one breath.
Oh, please don't do that now.
No. I'm so excited. First of all, we have the... I can't believe that it's... Is this the third?
This is the third annual banjo award that you have created and fund.
Every year it goes to who you believe is picked by a panel of banjo experts.
Yes. And this sculpture is created by Eric Fischel, one of the great American artists. And the award is accompanied by a $50,000 prize, which, as you know, is funded by 8-year-old Chinese laborers. And and it's used to promote the great banjo players in America who would otherwise go unheralded.
See, this is what I'm talking about. You are an accomplished banjoist yourself.
Well.
Yeah. Now, look at this, ladies and gentlemen. I'm also very excited about this. This is a collection of Steve Martin work, it's just limited to television, I believe.
It's 40 years.
40 years that he's been on television, and it's all compiled into this three or four discs. How many discs are in there?
Three discs and about 6 hours.
Six hours? So this is a remarkable thing, and is in stores now?
It's available. It's available, internet, stores.
However they sell stuff.
And it has a clip from our... From my appearances on your show, which are some of my favorite bits.
Oh, well, that's very flattering.
That's a great clip. We arranged to show the clip.
Let's take a look. From a clip from this show in the package.
Yes,
all right,
absolutely.
Let's see. Take a look. Steve Martin.
Favorite clip.
Steve Martin. Steve.
You remember that? That was good, huh?
Yeah. Well, that's just stupid.
Now, let's. Do you mind if we just get on with the?
What are you going to do?
The banjo thing.
We're going to. Is the winner here tonight?
Yes.
Which one is the winner?
The winner is there, Mark Johnson.
Mark Johnson.
And that's his partner, Emory Lester. Mm-hmm.
They'll be performing with you in a minute.
Yes, in a minute. And calm down. And and Mark Johnson is a fantastic player in the clawhammer style, which is different from the three-finger style, the scrug style. Mm-hmm. The scrug style is played with picks, and clawhammer style is played without picks. It's played with the back of the fingernail, and
which
it's a beautiful
you,
American
Which do you
style.
Do?
I play both, and I'm going to play with Mark Johnson tonight in the clawhammer style.
Okay, great. Is that what we're going to do now?
That's what we're going to do.
All right, so please welcome performing a song from the CD... Steve Martin, Emory Lester, and prize winner Mark Johnson, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go. Acoustic campaign.
Here we go. Thank you.
beautiful, ladies and gentlemen. Very nice, Steve. Congratulations. And here you are,
Mark
sir.
Johnson.
Mark, congratulations.
Oh, my
to you.
Thank you
very much. Good to see you as well. Here, you can hold that so we all have something. Well, there you go. As always, it's our friend Steve Martin and his friends. Thank you very much for being here. We'll be right back with Gaudier, everybody.
That's what we go for.
Very tight.
We're trying. Tight is right.
Our first guest, a true Renaissance man. He's an accomplished actor, comedian, writer, and musician. And he has a brand new album of music with Edie Brickell. How about Edie Brickell, by the way?
Oh, the
Remember
best.
When she used to be on the show?
Oh, yeah, what did we hear?
Oh, my God. With the New Bohemians?
Yeah, those were the days,
that
yeah.
Was exciting.
Brilliant.
And then, guess what? She ran off and married Paul Simon.
Yeah. Still together, happy, you
yeah,
know?
Family. But what a family. Lovely
yeah.
woman.
Lovely. Three and kids, she, I think they got three kids.
And she's here here tonight, and yeah. She and Steve Martin have produced this work collection of music, so we're very happy to have both of them. By the way, it's called Love Has Come For You, and it's in stores now, so I hope you can stay through the show before you run out and get one. Ladies and gentlemen, here's our good friend Steve Martin. Come on out here. Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Beautiful suit. Thank you. Man.
Ah, thank you. You know, Dave, I was so excited to be on the show tonight.
Thank you.
But it turns out I am currently in Europe and unable to be here.
Well, now that doesn't... Now, wait a minute. That, does that make any sense? Is he coming back? That makes no sense. Is he coming back, or...?
You're here. You're here. You're supposed to, you should be over there. You're here. Just have a seat and be funny. Right over there, Steve.
Steve.
Please, please.
Thanks, Biff. Yeah. Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Wow.
That was hilarious.
That was crazy.
I actually am. I love doing your show.
Oh, that's nice.
One reason I'm glad, and the second reason I'm glad to be here is a gift basket is a gift basket.
Yes. I want to tell you something. I've known you a long time. You have never looked better. First of all, the suit is tremendous.
Thank you very much.
You look great. You look young. And congratulations. You and your wife, a beautiful baby, recently a baby boy.
Oh, gosh, thank you for reminding me. Thank you very much.
That's a baby monitor.
Exactly, baby monitor.
Well, where is the baby?
Baby back at the hotel, and I'm a responsible...
That's great.
Isn't that sweet?
Yeah.
I think I left the window open.
Oh, what's that?
A little cough. Who cares? What's a couple? Big deal.
Wait a minute.
Very good. Baby is very, very good on the banjo.
Daddy,
yeah, yeah.
I need my
yeah,
daddy.
Yeah.
That's remarkable,
daddy,
Steve.
Daddy, I need my daddy. Daddy.
Oh, please,
daddy,
quiet,
daddy,
quiet. Please, that's enough of that. All right.
The baby, congratulations, a lovely little girl. That's very sweet.
Yes,
congratulations.
Yes, yes.
How are things going?
It's going great. First of all, going great because I have a wonderful wife and mother.
That's
that
good.
Makes it really. I mean,
yeah,
I'm not.
Yeah.
I'm paying her a compliment.
Yeah.
And everything is funny when I try to be serious, yeah.
But
I guess that's good.
What's the
nature of my business?
The baby's name?
Thought about the name quite a bit. Conquistador, what do you think?
Wait, now
You're saying the baby's name is Conquistador?
Yeah, I didn't want to go with one of those Hollywood, you know how they have to come up with the weird names.
Yeah, that's right.
Conquistador says it's a statement.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
I would have thought it was Conquistador. You're saying it's Conquistador.
I believe it to be. It's a Spanish word.
Okay, Conquistador. Conquistador Martin.
Should there be a hyphen?
No, or? No, it's fine.
Maybe the Q should be a capital.
Oh, you're just fine. I've admired you so many times for so many different reasons. You're a man of wide-ranging interests, but you're not really a political comedian, are you?
No, I never did that. I had a reason for it, too, because being an actor and a non-political comedian, I didn't want laughs to be colored by, if I'm playing a role, for example, I didn't want the audience to think, he's a lefty or a righty, you know. And I don't believe the audience really wants to know what my theory is about the shape of the human skull and, based on those skull shapes, who should live and who should die.
Going to be a long, difficult life for the baby. You know what I saw you in?
By the way, if you toss a baby into the air...
Oh, no.
Do you catch it? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Good to know.
I saw you today. There's a documentary, I'm sure you're well aware of this, about Ricky Jay, the magician.
He's fantastic.
Yes.
He's been a lifelong friend.
That's what is explained in the documentary, and I
really... My only one.
No, no. But fascinating and historically dense with information about magicians and magic for hundreds of years, he's really.
Great. Is he going to be on the show?
I hope he's going to be on the show.
Oh, yeah. He's fantastic.
Now, you, for a while, did a magic act. You were the Great Flydini.
I did the Great Flydini, but I also started as a magician.
That's right.
And I worked at Disneyland.
Uh-huh.
And I did tricks, 8 to 12 hours a day for the audience. And that's how you become good at something.
Yeah.
Unlike doing something for an hour a day.
I don't know why.
You know, I'll tell you something.
I'm just sitting here.
You know, I'm thinking about, the late night wars and all this, and I'm thinking that some comedians just say funny things, and some comedians say things funny.
Right.
But you...
Yeah.
Say things.
Thanks. That's nice.
Yeah.
I'm very excited about this. Edie Brickell. How long have you known Edie Brickell?
I've known her over 20 years, but we just started working together in the last really year, 14 months.
I think I've known her longer than you have.
Oh, I don't think that's
possible. No, I
possible.
Think I have.
I don't think,
I've known her longer.
You have?
Yeah, she used to be on the old show years and years.
How come you're not working with her then?
Well, maybe I am. Maybe I'm doing an album.
Oh, I'd like to see that.
Yeah, well, maybe.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Maybe I'll come on your show and we'll do a number from our album.
You know that I don't have a show.
All right, well. See what we can do about getting him a show. When we come back, Edie Brickell will be here. Brickell, ladies and gentlemen. Nice to see you, Edie. Thank you for being here. I was talking to Paul earlier about when you used to come and be on the old show. It was so delightful to have you here, and then and now. And then your career changed. You became a mom and had three kids, and we were just talking about them, and there one's like 20 and one's 18 and some. That's
By the
crazy.
Way, are you talking to me?
No.
Oh.
If I was talking to you, you'd still be in this chair.
Okay. I'm sorry. Somehow the questions didn't apply, and I was
confused. Yeah, no, it's fine.
Confused.
You can go back to sleep.
Okay.
Anyway, it's great to have you back, and
Thank
congratulations
you.
On everything.
Thanks so much.
You remember when you would come on the show?
I remember it.
You it was were, fun. Oh, it was so much fun.
I was so excited and nervous at the same time, but you were always so nice
How do you feel
nice
now?
To me. I guess the same. But...
New Bohemians, what happened to those guys?
I still play with those guys. They're right? down in Texas, living large, mm-hmm. sweet guys.
I always remember you as somebody who liked whiskey. Am I right about that?
I like it all, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, well. How did you and Steve begin the musical collaboration?
I told him I was a big fan of his music, and if he ever wanted to write a song together, I'd love to do it. And he said, I have a tune. And then I thought, well, that's that then.
Yeah.
But the next week, he actually called up and said, so do you want to hear this tune? And we got together, and he played it for me.
So your responsibility was the lyrics, writing the lyrics of the music that he was supplying? Is that how it works?
Yeah, I would just sing along to his banjo tunes until a song came about.
Now, is the banjo easy to sing along to?
Yeah.
Now, Steve, have you ever written music?
Are you talking to me now?
Yes, now. Now I am talking to you.
Don't you?
It's not that complicated.
I have two previous albums. I wrote every song on there.
I know, but I'm talking about, do you supply lyrics to songs?
Yes, I have. Yes, I wrote the lyrics on the song. So, yes, I have written.
Forgive my ignorance.
But Edie is a much better lyricist than I am, and she's an artistic lyric writer, and she wrote.
And not only that, an excellent musician and a wonderful voice. Now, do you ever do any vocals on this music?
On one cut, I sing along a mm-hmm. duet with Edie.
How did that happen?
I leave this to her because she's great at it.
Right. But were you comfortable singing?
Ish.
Great.
I keep thinking I did have a hit single when I sang.
Oh, that's right. I do remember the King Tut deal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I was thinking of Candle in the Wind, but King Tut, too, yeah.
Something wrong with him. So what kind of stuff is on there? You have like 10 or 12 songs, and what kind of things? One is a sad song about suicide, for God's sakes.
No, that's the happy tune that sings things on.
It was the strangest thing, as you know, I would send her a melody on the banjo, and then these songs would come back with the lyrics written, and one of them is a upbeat tune. It's a faster kind of upbeat tune about suicide.
Long, difficult life for the daughter. But now, Edie, when you would get Steve music, would you go to your husband, Paul Simon, and say, listen to this? Or was he helpful in the process?
No, he never heard it. He didn't hear it until about a month ago when our album was made.
Yeah. And you guys are going on tour this summer, is that correct?
Yes, we are.
Like, how long will you be gone?
We keep the tour manageable. We're doing, we start in Fort Myers, Florida on May 22nd, and then we do about 9 days at the end of May, June and July, and then some in October. Yeah.
This will be great, and I would like to travel with you too.
You can. We have a bus.
Come on.
Well, I'm not getting on a bus. I won't be getting on the bus.
We were thinking of you driving.
Oh. I mean, honest to God, ladies and gentlemen. Well, the name of the CD is Love Has Come For You, the delightful Edie Brickell and the sort of delightful Steve Martin. And the other interesting thing about the album, our friend Martin Mull did the cover art, and if you turn it over...
And that, by the way, that's a painting. It's not a photograph. That's a painting he did.
And there you two have replicated Martin Mull's painting that Mr. Martin owns, as I understand.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah. And how is Martin Mull? Great.
He's fantastic. Yeah, he's still doing comedy in a sitcom.
Very funny man and a very talented...
And quite a painter. Yeah. He's been painting his whole life.
And how's your friend Paul doing?
Oh, he's great. Thank you for asking. Great. Yeah.
Does Garfunkel ever come around?
I'm never home if he does.
I see.
I haven't seen him.
The two of them, Steve and Edie, ladies and gentlemen, will be back later to do a song from their lovely new CD. We'll be right back with Jenna Fisher. It's so nice to see you. Okay. Thank you, Paul.
Our next guests have combined their musical talents to create this wonderful new album entitled Love Has Come For You. Please welcome now, along with the Steep Canyon Rangers, Steve Martin and Edie Brickell. Kids, take it away. Steve, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
You are so much better than that. Got a guy playing a block back there. That was lovely. And the rest of the collection is just as lovely. And it was so nice to have both of you here. Thank you so much. Steve Martin, Edie Brickell, the Steep Canyon Rangers. Have a lovely night. Love has come to you. Good night, everybody.
Now, stay tuned for Craig Ferguson. This is Alan Coffey speaking. Good night, everybody.
Thank you, and thank you again, and hello. Okay.
Hello in there.
I feel like the show actually begins now this guy. I mean, you can't go wrong.
No.
No. Our first guest is an actor, writer, musician, and is a true Renaissance man. This is the Steve Martin Prize he created to award excellence in banjo and bluegrass. Look at that. And we are lucky enough that he's presented that to the winner for the last 3 or 4 years.
It's a great tradition.
That's right. And he continues to perform on tour. Oh, my God, Edie Brickell. What would you give up to go on tour with Edie Brickell?
Everything. You know, everything.
Me too. He's touring with Edie Brickell and the Steep Canyon Rangers beginning October 2nd in Seattle. Ladies and gentlemen, here he is, Steve Martin. Steve, come on out here. Steve.
Oh,
Steve.
Boy.
Nice to have you with us, my friend. How
Finally,
are you doing?
I can relax an audience.
That's right. Great to have you here, and by gosh,
did you just read that?
Yeah, I'm just looking
at it. Great to have you here.
Great to have you here.
Wow.
We leave nothing to chance.
By the way, congratulations, your 20th anniversary.
Oh, well, that was some time ago, but thank you. Thank you.
Nice I was going to send you a note, and I thought, that's a lot of work.
Yeah.
and my assistant was on vacation.
Right, so.
And I thought, well, I'm going to be on the show. Why don't I just come out and blah, 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 blah.
Well, I appreciate it anyway. Yeah. Thank you very much.
And those 20 years.
Here at CBS, right?
Yeah, here at CBS. Mm-hmm. They just seem to go by exactly like 20 years would go by. It was not. It didn't
fly by.
No, it did not fly by.
Right.
Nor did it seem too long.
Uh-huh.
And you seem to be the appropriate age for 20 years having gone by.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. And I know.
Mission accomplished.
Also. But it was. You had an. You have another. You did another show. So you're actually on the air for
30 years. 30 plus. Yeah.
30 plus years. Yeah. So what I'm thinking is, if you didn't get the hoopla that you wanted for your 20th, it's because people really couldn't grasp what was going on, because you got the 20 and then you got the 30 plus.
Yes, the
and
math.
You're going, I don't really know what's going on.
Right. So, well, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Somehow I feel much better. but this is something, when I heard about this, I thought, this is wonderful, and congratulations. Do you mind if I tell people?
Oh, please. Please. I don't know what you're going to say,
The Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, whatever they call themselves.
Yes.
The Academy Award people are bestowing on you an honorary Academy Award.
That's true.
Well, congratulations.
Yes, thank you very much.
Wow.
You know, honestly, this is something I never thought would happen, because comedy tends to be ignored by the Academy. I think I can only think of, well, there's a couple. There's Charlie Chaplin, and I think in recent history, it was Roberto Benigni.
Oh, that's right.
And you could argue Tom Hanks got one for Forrest Gump, if that's you want to call that a comedy.
Yeah.
I mean, he did get one. I'm saying, but you could argue whether Forrest Gump is a comedy.
Right.
It's more of a serious kind of film. So we are both exactly right. Thank you.
But anyway. Annie Hall, a comedy, a romantic
definitely,
comedy.
Yeah. Definitely. That's
But other than that, you're right.
Other than those 19 examples that have contradicted what I just said. But it was amazing, because I thought, you know, there's really no chance, and I really didn't think about it. And then a couple of weeks ago, I got a phone call, a message left by Cheryl Isaacs Boone, who is the head board of governors of the Academy, and she left a message, and I thought, what is this about?
Sure.
You know, the Academy calling me, and I started thinking, oh, I'll bet I know what this is. They want me to be that person who gets up at 5 a.m. to announce the nominees. You know, and you have to go there at 5 so they can get the East Coast news. And I started thinking, you know, I've hosted the Oscars 3 times, and now they want me to get up at 5 a.m. to announce the nominees who are not me. And now I'm getting madder and madder, and I finally call her back. What is it? They said, we want to give you an honorary Oscar. And I was really flattered and deeply moved. You know, because the great thing about it is you can't lose.
No. That's exactly right.
And
it's not like you're nominated for an honorary Oscar.
Yeah. You know, they don't go, and the winner is not you.
Yeah.
And
I'll bet over the history of the Academy, fewer of these have been presented than the actual competitive.
You know, I never thought of it that way.
So it is, and it's for a body of work. So that
that's very nice. Congratulations. Yeah. Now, will we see this on the telecast? Will this be part
of it's
show?
Not televised, but, which is another great thing, actually. I there was a time in my life when I would wanted to, you know, be out there, and now I like the relative peace and quiet. Right. It'll probably be webcast, I guess.
Do they FedEx it to you, or how do you get the?
No, you go to a.
You just sign for it. Not a bad deal.
You go to a dinner, and I am able to invite some of the people closest to me. Sorry. And you'll be doing a show.
I'll be really busy, Steve.
Yeah. You know, people that friends I've made in my film career.
Yes, I understand perfectly.
For example, I'm inviting my makeup man.
Your makeup? I think that's a lovely idea.
Yeah. And several people. Mm-hmm. So, and you make a little warm speech. You don't have to be funny. You can just be sincere.
Well, this is great, and I'm proud for you, and proud that we know you. So,
and
thank
also,
you very much.
You don't really know me, by the way. And the other, for example, Angelina Jolie is getting one for humanitarian work. And
great,
I think
great humanitarian.
Really deserves that. Yeah. And Piero Tosi, whom I don't know, he was he's a great costume designer.
Yes, I really
Italian.
Know him.
Yeah,
I really know him.
And Angela Lansbury.
Oh, Angela Lansbury. Oh, yeah. My God. Yeah. Talk about a body of work. This woman, I mean, from when she was a teenager, has been working in one great film after another.
Well, I hope she doesn't overshadow me.
And what will you wear?
I'll be wearing a tuxedo.
Well, you look good in a tuxedo.
Yeah, thank you very
much. Do you worry about what you wear?
Yes, I'm not a fashion plate. I don't.
Well,
think
we can
I
see
have a,
that.
I see my tie has shifted. Well, I have a fashion question for you.
Oh, okay.
Because I've noticed you wear double-breasted suits. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure they're available somewhere. And but no, I think a double-breasted suit can be fantastic. But you don't button them, so they kind of flap open. So we're seeing a part of a suit that really wasn't meant to be seen. Like the lining and the backs of the buttons and things like that, and they kind of blouse out. Mm-hmm. And I'm just thinking, why? You know, it gives you kind of a shape like this. Yeah. And I'm thinking, why don't you just wear a little short dress instead?
All right, I think you make a good point. Yeah. Like a little, is it a shift? Is it what they call
it? I don't know, an A-line.
Yeah,
an
that's,
A-line.
That's good.
It's very nice.
Yeah.
But I'm curious why you don't button
I don't button it for the same reason you didn't write me a note. I just, I don't have the energy to do it.
It's, how many dressers do you have backstage?
I don't know, and I don't care. But we'll be right back here with Academy Award winner Steve Martin, everybody. Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Now I'm very conscious of my attire.
No, you're delightful. But
how sweet of you to say.
But you and I are same age.
Yeah,
essentially
I think so.
The same age.
Yeah.
And when I look at a guy that's my age, I always think, oh man, he looks so much better than I do. Now, do you have some kind of? You agree with that?
No, I mean I that happens to me too.
Oh,
I
really?
Always looking at somebody my age and thinking, yeah, but he's trim.
No,
I put on
shape.
A few pounds and I went on a diet. About 8 weeks ago, and I thought, okay, I'm going to lose some weight, and I decided to videotape it.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, and I thought, I'm going to document this, and I brought the tape.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah. I brought the tape on the show because
this
I thought...
It would be good for other people our age.
Yeah, we could might learn a little something, and it might help others.
Okay, all right, so we just go ahead and
roll the tape,
right,
I guess.
Steve
Martin
and his new diet regimen.
It's homemade, so, you know.
Yeah.
First, weigh yourself on the most accurate scale you can find. Instead of eating at restaurants, it's healthier to cook your meals at home. Remember, you don't have to go to the gym to exercise. You can get a good workout right in your very own home. And one, and two, and one. And always remember to stay hydrated. A healthy dinner option is corn, potatoes, and even on a vegetarian diet, a little steak won't hurt you. Also remember to exercise portion control. Here, I'm dividing my meal in half. I'm putting half of my meal in my dog's food bowl and half my wine in his water bowl. Mmm, that was delicious. But you know, I'm still feeling a little bit hungry. Follow these simple rules and watch the pounds melt away. And here I am, before and after.
That's remarkable.
Yeah.
I want to... That part where you're eating out of the dog's bowl,
that's,
you know, I want to get that to the Academy Award people immediately.
You know, I say, if when you're a success in business, mm-hmm. you end up, you know, wearing a suit and maybe you're on a boat. But when you're a success in comedy, you end up riding on an elephant with a funny hat.
Yes, that's right. A whole different deal.
Yeah.
Now, but that's not all you're involved in.
Yes.
Speaking of business, tell the folks about the, I was surprised about this, a new video game.
Oh, the video game. Well, you know, we do banjo touring with Edie Brickell and Steep Canyon Rangers, mm-hmm. and there's merchandise, and we have a little, sure. you know, we sell CDs and T-shirts and mm-hmm. things, but the new thing is totally great. Can you show, it's a Grand Theft Banjo. Can you show the,
yeah. Really, Grand Theft Very, Banjo right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, and I have a clip from it. It's so exciting. They can run the clip.
Grand Theft
yes.
Banjo.
Yeah.
Hey, that's my banjo.
Oh, my. Now,
that's going to be huge, isn't it?
Yes, yes. I think we've sold 100,000 copies, and yet 150,000 have been returned.
Oh, no. Let me ask you about this. You know, I'm honored that this happens on our program every year, and I think this must be five years in a row.
It's 4 years. This is the award that the winner gets of our Banjo Award. The winner gets a prize of $50,000 and this beautiful sculpture made by Eric Fischel, great American artist. And the winner this year is Jens Kruger, and he's from Switzerland. He was born in Switzerland, and he's fully Americanized now. And he tours with his brother, Uwe Kruger, and Joel Landisberg, and they're the Kruger brothers. And they're a fantastic
They're going to
group.
Be here with
They're going
you
to be here later.
Later.
We're going
now,
to
who,
play something.
Who decides what the winner is, what are the qualifications, and who makes
we
the
We have
judgment?
A board consisting of some of the great banjo players in America and me. Mm-hmm. And some of the names you may know, Bela Fleck and Tony yes. Trischka, Pete Wernick, and Alison Brown, and it goes on and on and on.
And
we have scholars. And
I was not aware that the banjo was a big popular instrument in Europe. But
it is. It is. And you know where it's oddly very popular? Czechoslovakia. I know, they make banjos there. I know, it's strange. I so appreciate you having the winners on the show because it really is significant. They come on the show and they get the credit, you know, having appeared on the David Letterman show. I mean, I come on and I have to do 50 hours of community service. But they go on and they get...
Well, I'm sorry. I don't know, how. That's your own problem.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know how that happens.
And it's a big credit. And the winners have gone on. Their careers have expanded. And
well, it's a great thing for us because it's delightful. The kids are going to be out here. And I think...
They're not kids.
They're not kids.
They're
Did
men.
I say kids?
They're
These
men.
Are not
yeah, yeah.
kids,
yeah,
ladies
yeah.
and gentlemen.
Yeah.
But you fund this award, if
yes,
I ever
Yes, I fund it. And I don't know how, but we do. And now if you look... Here, we put the label on here, and these labels are made up every year. And Jens has, over the U, I don't know if you can see this, has these two little dots. Mm. And that put us over the top cost-wise, those two little dots. Yeah.
The umlaut.
Is that what it's called, an umlaut? Yeah. I couldn't think of the
budget name. Budget-busting umlaut.
Yeah. Now, do we have time to tell one quick story
yes,
about Jens?
Please, go right ahead.
Jens, when he was 9, he lived in Switzerland, and he heard the banjo, and he wanted to play it desperately. And his father, all he had was a banjo neck. And he got a chord book, and he just had the neck, and he learned all the chords on the banjo with just the neck and the chord book. And he had this neck for, I think it was 2 years. And then finally, he got the rest of the banjo, which is called the pot, and he stuck it on, and 2 weeks later, he did his first show.
Really?
Yeah.
That's remarkable.
It's amazing.
And you started the banjo the other way around.
I just had the pot.
So, see, yeah, different strokes for different folks. Anyway, the great Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen, will be back later with the Kruger Brothers, the winner of this year's Banjo Award. Nice to see you, Steve. Thank you. Great job. We'll be back with Kathleen Madigan. Delighted about this. This year's winner of the Steve Martin Prize for Excellence in Banjo and Bluegrass is Jens Kruger, and his group's album is entitled Best of the Kruger Brothers. Ladies and gentlemen, here they are, along with their good friend Steve, the Kruger Brothers. Kids. Thank you, folks. Thank you very much. Jens, great pleasure to have you with us. Great pleasure to meet you.
Thank you.
And congratulations. There you are, the Steve Martin Award. That was lovely.
Thank you.
You know, before I leave television, I'd kind of like to win one of those.
Okay, just a little practice.
Just whatever you can do, I'd certainly appreciate it. Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, the Steve Martin Banjo Award winner and the best of the Kruger Brothers. Thank you, gentlemen. Good pleasure to have you here. And thanks to you folks back there. Here he is, Academy Award winner Steve Martin. Good night, everybody.
Carter speaking. Good night, everybody.
We went into the archives.
Yeah.
We have a still shot of myself and Colleen Boyle. I believe in those days she worked at Sears.
Well, really?
Yeah. Now let's take a look and get ready. That's Colleen.
Well, that is.
Right. She looks great. She still looks great.
Yeah.
And I look like. Oh, what was that?
You put your finger on.
I look like Marie Osmond.
Marie.
Well.
Our first guest is an actor, writer, musician, a true Renaissance man, and a good friend of ours. We're lucky to have him with us. Ladies and gentlemen, the one, the only, Steve Martin.
I want to take a selfie.
Steve, how are you? Great to see you. Thank
man,
you very much.
This is a moment.
Yeah. You've been on the show so many, many, many
yes,
times.
Yes, I have.
And thank you for your friendship and all of your entertainment.
Thank you.
You know, a lot of people come on the show and just keep the cab running so they can run in, run out. But you have actually come and produced things and helped produce
Thank
things
you.
And made things better and always funny whenever you're on the show. God bless you, and
Thank
I'll
you.
Never be able to repay you.
Yes,
thank you.
Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you. When you...
True story.
I'll be... When I heard you announce that you were retiring, I really thought, he's joking. He's got to be joking. Yeah. And then I remembered, wait, you're not funny.
Ha ha ha!
But seriously, I've done this show, I don't know, 40 or 50 times. Oh, quite. Every time I've waited behind that curtain, I've been a little nervous or, you know, wanting it to go well, thinking, well, this is joke, you know. But tonight, I just felt, finally, it's over.
Mm-hmm. Really? It's over. Well,
and I am, you know, I was on, when I saw that clip of Johnny, and that was so sweet. And he invited me to be on the last week of his show.
Last week?
Yes, and it's quite an honor, and I'm very honored to be invited to be on your last month, kind of vaguely. Yeah.
Well, we've had you penciled in for a long time.
Yeah.
And what is new with you? What
I've been...
You're so busy. I know there's a musical in the works.
There's a musical? Well, I actually just finished two shows with Marty Short.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
When you and Marty Short work together, that's fantastic.
Yeah. And we worked Detroit and Mount Pleasant, and mm-hmm. they were sold out, and we had a good time.
Right. Now, did you ever just think about working by yourself?
Is I could definitely work by myself. I work with the Steep Canyon Rangers.
Oh, they're great.
But with Marty, you know... He threatens me with revenge porn if I...
Really?
Yeah. But I finally have something on him.
It's
a photo taken backstage. Would you like to take a look at it?
Would I?
Yes.
All right, let's take a look. Martin Short taken backstage.
There he is.
Honest to God, what kind of show are the two of you doing? Seriously, good Lord.
Talking about the musical, you know, Edie Brickell and I wrote a musical.
I love Edie Brickell.
Yeah, she's fantastic.
More than life itself. Yep, she's a delight, and what a talent.
She is, yeah. And she's a kind, nice, good person, too. Mm-hmm. That's not often the case with partners. And...
Well, you know, she's married to Paul Simon.
I know that. Yeah. I found that out.
Garfunkel's place.
And, you know, we have this Broadway show. We did it at the Old Globe Theater in San Diego, and it was a big hit there. And now we're waiting for a theater.
So you're going to bring it to Broadway?
Yes, we're bringing
it to
Comfrey in Broadway.
This is going to be great.
Waiting for a theater in Broadway is kind of like when you become king. Hmm. It only happens if someone dies. So you have to wait for a show to close. And of course, you're wishing them the best.
Yeah. Do you have your eye on any particular show that's showing signs of anemia?
Why not this theater?
Come on in.
You're on Broadway.
That's right. Oh, that would be great. That would be just fantastic. And this is a huge undertaking.
Yes.
And you have talented friends.
Yes.
People who have been through it before must have given you advice along the way.
Mike Nichols, God rest his soul, a fantastic man, gave us some great advice. He said, never go to a birthday party of someone who has written a musical. Mm. And I said, why? And he said, because they'll play you all the songs that were cut from the show.
You don't want that. No, not at all. Mm-hmm. How long have we been friends? I guess you alluded to 30... No, you go back to the
morning show. Yeah, I was on the show then, but that doesn't make us friends. I would say...
Is this the way you behave with Johnny?
Yeah. I would not behave with Johnny that way.
No, I wouldn't
guess
so. He
might have laughed.
Yeah.
But I'd say we became friends at a later point, wouldn't you say?
I mean, this is an interesting discussion because there is show business friends.
Yes.
And then there's actual friendship.
Yes. And we're neither.
and often they don't overlap.
Yeah, that's true.
Mm-hmm. But here, lately,
I feel
there seems to be some overlap because I think you and I are strange in the same way.
I think so, too. You know, I think you're a very interesting person, and I can't tell you how many times I have wanted to be a fly on the wall in your office, you know, rather than out here. But, you know, I wanted to get you a gift, and I know that
you don't want a gift, and I
understand that. I don't want a gift either, but you've given me gifts, and I just love to get you something, but what could it be? And I think I finally figured it out.
Well, let me just say before you present it, a gift from Steve Martin will mean so much to me for the rest of my life and for my family beyond.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All right.
Well, tell them about it, Alan.
What? Wait a minute.
Dave, it's a brand new set of luggage. This three-piece set from Samsonite features push-button locking handles, tie-down garment straps, and front zipper pockets. Retail value, $172. Luggage not usable in the United States. Back to you, Dave.
Thanks. Wow. That's beautiful.
And I meant every piece of it.
Did you get that from the store on Broadway?
I don't know where it was going. I don't buy your gifts myself.
No, of course not. We'll be right back with Steve Martin. Gosh, that was nice.
That was very nice. See that photo?
I think that was the morning show.
I think it was my first appearance on your show.
I think you came out in a bed.
I did.
Right? Yeah.
It was an early morning.
That's
kind
funny.
Of. Yeah. It was funny at the time.
It's still funny.
You know, I was backstage reminiscing with your staff about you and the show, and you know, just saying what a great guy you are, and they said, you know, we cannot wait to meet him. And
well,
here's what I did. It's been such a long and fantastic career that I put together a kind of homage video.
Really? Oh, that's great.
A history of your life. And I wanted to call it This Is Your Life, but I found out that title is copyright and sacrosanct, so I had to change the title. But anyway, this is my little video I put together for
about
you of your life.
Well, God bless you, Steve. I guess we'll just take a look right there. Thank you, Steve.
David Letterman, This Are Your Life. You had a show, and then you had another show.
I mean, I'll have one, too. Thank you.
Wow, Steve. That was something.
Yeah. But seriously, I thought about your life after, after you... You know, I don't think you're going to retire. I really don't think
I have nothing to do.
I think you're going to be surprised with how much you're going to have to
do.
Well, look at me.
So.
I'm not here.
Yeah, but you have never retired, nor will you.
Bah. So I put together a little video of your life after retirement show you things you might enjoy. So
this
here
is,
we'll roll that little, video.
See this as well.
Yeah.
Kind of a primer.
This is your new life, David Letterman. After your heartfelt farewell, you'll be thrown out of the theater immediately. You'll ride a Greyhound bus to Atlantic City, where you'll play 8 hours of penny slots. You'll never miss taking your medication thanks to your deluxe new pill timer, courtesy of CBS. You'll enjoy 4 p.m. dinners at the Golden Corral, savoring your brand new diet of soft foods with, quote, friends who stuck by you. You'll vacation alone on the beautiful beaches of Newfoundland, where your summer home will feature the newest luxurious amenities, like a bench in your shower, an easy commute to the second floor, and an all-purpose cart. And from a phone with giant numbers, you'll receive weekly calls from relatives checking in on you.
Still alive.
And then an all-expense-paid visit to heaven. David Letterman, this is your new life.
Woo. Oh, my God.
Wow.
Steve. I don't know.
I was crying at the first one. I didn't know how much I was going to cry.
Oh, that was just remarkable. And, my God, something for the archives. What a wonderful, wonderful moment.
Yeah.
We'll be right back. Let's see what else Steve has. Yeah.
Martin.
Steve Marr, I don't want to embarrass you, but won a Grammy, right? Best comedy album?
I've won 5 Grammys, but go ahead.
Yeah. All right, yeah. 5 Grammys.
Yeah.
Steve Marr. Emmy?
I won 5 Emmys, but I can't. I've won 1.
1? Yep. When you worked on the Smothers Brothers
as a writer.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Academy Award.
Yes.
Academy Award, ladies and gentlemen, for his contribution to film comedy. That's a pretty good deal. Nice going.
Thank you. That's right. But, you know, I'm going to tell you something. In looking back, I'm being serious now, about all the times I've been on the show, I do believe that some of my funniest moments have been on this show, looking back in hindsight.
Well, all credit to you.
Wow. I just realized hindsight is such an ugly word. Mm-hmm. Just horrible implications of eyes and
easy
things. Yeah. But anyway, and one of the bits we did together, which I just loved, and I understand you get a lot of requests.
Yes, and it was all, I believe, was your idea and mostly of your production, really.
Well, I staffed help, but thank you very much. Mm-hmm. You want to look at it?
Yes, yeah. What is it called?
It's called Dave and Steve's Gay Vacation.
October 2nd, 1998.
Oh, Dave.
Hey, Steve.
Oh, good show.
Yeah, you were great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You were good, too.
No.
No, you set me up great.
No, the audience loved you.
Yeah,
I thought. Well,
they were a good audience.
Yeah, because of you, you know? Yeah. Seriously.
Well, you doing okay?
I'm fine.
Yeah.
I'm fine. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, I guess I better go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, I have to go, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How are you doing? Good to see you.
Nice to see you.
This is Catherine.
Hi.
How do you do, Catherine?
Hi.
This is Nadine.
Hi, Nadine.
Catherine. Hi, how are you?
Hi. Nice
well,
to meet you.
It's good to see you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Bye.
Go again.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yes. Looking, you know. Looking back, it wasn't so much a gay vacation as a boys' vacation.
No, it was, like, well,
frolicking
speak for yourself, but I'm still deeply in love. Now, when we come back, this is going to be fantastic. Steve and some musical friends will be honoring us with a special performance. We'll look forward to that. Steve Martin, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back.
Wow.
This is, I mean, I don't know what to say. The collection of musicians we have represented here tonight, Hall of Fame stuff, right down the line. Everybody here.
So true.
We're very happy, delighted to have this group of musicians to perform. It's a gospel classic. Do me a favor, welcome Emmy Lou Harris, Rodney Crowell. His forthcoming album is entitled The Traveling Kind, along with Mark O'Connor, Amos Lee, and our friend Steve Martin. Thank you very much, everybody.
I was standing by the window on a cold and cloudy day when I saw that hearse come running, thought to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? Home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. I said to the undertaker, please drive slow. For this lady you are carrying, Lord, I hate to see her go. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
One by one, they were unseated. One by one, they were led away. Now the family has departed. Will we join them all one day?
Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky. Sisters crying, what a home so sad and alone. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. We sang songs of childhood and the faith that made us strong. Ones that mother made their daughters hear the angels sing along. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better
lovely. Just lovely. Emmy, Lou Harris, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dave.
God, that was beautiful. Mark O'Connor, thank you very much, Mark. Amos, good to see you. Rodney, thank you very much. Mr. Martin. I don't know. That's it. That's all you want. Thank you, everybody. Have a great weekend. Good night, folks.
Now, stay tuned for James Corden. This is Alan Coulter speaking. Good night, everybody.
Please welcome Mr. Andy Kaufman. Tell me about Taxi. Would you like a tissue? Would you like a tissue?
Oh, my. Dear Andy.
Oh, my goodness.
Dear Andy. Ladies and gentlemen, here's tonight's top 10. Thank you, Paul. This is a, I think this is a pretty good list, considering it's our last list, and the category, top 10 things I've always wanted to say to Dave.
Ah.
Yeah. Now listen to this. Presenting tonight's top 10 list, 10 frequent late show guests and good friends of ours. Once again, top 10 things, and let me just thank them in advance. I appreciate their time, their talents, and their generosity. Top 10 things I've always wanted to say to Dave. Number 10, Alec Baldwin.
Of all the talk shows, yours is most geographically convenient to my home.
Thank you, Alec. Thank you. Number 9, Barbara Walters.
Okay. Dave, did you know that you wear the same cologne as Muammar Gaddafi?
Yes. Yes, Barbara. I do know that. Number 8, Steve Martin.
Your extensive plastic surgery was a necessity and a mistake.
Well, number 7, Jerry Seinfeld.
Dave, I have no idea what I'll do when you go off the air. You know, I just thought of something. I'll be fine.
Thank you, Jerry. It's very nice of you. And I think Jerry may have a benefit later. Number 6, Jim Carrey.
Honestly, Dave, I've always found you to be a bit of an overactor.
Number 5, Chris Rock.
I'm just glad your show is being given to another white guy.
Number You know, I had nothing to do with that. Number four, Julia Louis-Dreyfus, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks for letting me take part in another hugely disappointing series finale.
I had nothing to do with that either. Number three, Peyton Manning. Oh my God! Look at that guy.
Dave, you are to comedy what I am to comedy.
It doesn't make any sense. Peyton! Oh my God! Number two, Tina Fey.
Thanks for finally proving men can be funny.
I like that. Things I've always wanted to say to Dave. Number one, Bill Murray, ladies and gentlemen.
Dave, I'll never have the money I owe you.
Oh, no. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Chris,
how you doing? That was great, man.
Oh my God, the show is tremendous this year. That was so funny. Mr. Manning, oh my God, look who it is. That's unbelievable. Nina, again, thank you for everything. And Bill,
I saw you on TV.
Friends here at the Late Show. Thank you, everybody. We'll be right back, folks.
No, you guys really did great. Thank you so much.
No, no, I'll show you again.
How are you? Thank you. I'm great.
See you, Mark. We love you.